Hallelujah. Kids, you can head out to Sunday school. For the rest of you, I'd like you to turn to the book of Matthew, chapter 22. As you can see by the great Exodus, you understand why we need more Sunday school teachers. Praise the Lord. Amen. So for the next several weeks, I would like to convey a message of hope. And I think a lot of people one day will be shocked on who makes it to heaven. I think in many religions that are out in the world, that people think they got it right, are going to wake up one day and realize they got it wrong. And then there are going to be the religions that somewhat believe like we believe, but believe in a religion, not a relationship. They believe in rules and regulations, not in a true born-again relationship. And it's a relationship. We cannot lose focus on that. And any good, healthy relationship is built on honesty. You need to be honest with yourself and with the other person. Now, here's what's really cool about a relationship with the Lord. He already knows everything in my closet. There's nothing hidden from him. I mean, it blows my mind in the Last Supper where Jesus is saying the one who's going to betray me is the one who dips his bread with me now, and there's Judas. And he's like, no, it's not I, Lord. And he's like, it is you. I'm God. I know everything. I'm paraphrasing because I think we all understand he's God and he knows everything. So we need to be honest with ourselves when we say, do we have a relationship with God? And can I tell you something? Every relationship can seem somewhat different. You know, in certain relationship, one talks more than the other. My wife's wondering why some men are laughing, but I'm with you, brother. You know, relationships are different, but there's always an understanding in that relationship, an intimacy of knowing each other if it's a good, healthy relationship. Harley, you've been with your young lady for how many years? 19 years. She had to remind him. That's a good relationship. But you know each other. You know your goods, your bad, your indifference. You can't be together for 19 years and without knowing each other's backyard. Am I right? Amen?
Amen.
You know? Who is the greatest support in your life? If you're married, it's your spouse. If you're not married, it's your mother. You know? I mean, mom knows everything. You know, my mother always knew. I mean, I'd sneak into the house. It's 3 or 4 in the morning, you know, thinking I got away with something. I didn't. You know, when I moved out of the house, my mother said to me, I know every one of you. She's talking about all my brothers. I go, what do you mean you know each one of you? He says, I know every one of your hearts. He says, I know when you would come sneaking in at 3 or 4 o'clock in the morning. You think I sleep not knowing that you're in the house? I don't. They know everything. And God does. He knows everything about you, and he wants you to be open and honest with him. And we need to be that way if we expect to make it to heaven. You can't hide from him. You can't put up a front. You know, it's genuine. And Jesus is having an issue with the religious leaders of that day, the ones who were supposed to be representing him. The ones who should have known he was the Messiah more than anybody else. The religious leaders of that day, the ones who knew the Old Testament inside and out, can quote verse after verse after verse, but they were blind because there was no true relationship. And they rejected him as Messiah. Many people say, well, I believe in Jesus. Well, listen, the devil believes in Jesus. And he believes every word that is written in the Bible because he knows God doesn't lie. Knowing somebody doesn't mean we have a relationship. I know a lot of people. Doesn't mean I have a relationship with them. And see here in Matthew 22, Jesus is opening up with a great analogy. He was excellent in analogies. He was excellent in parables. And he knew the culture of that day. So he knew, he was the greatest wordsmith around. And so he knew how to present a story where everybody around him would have been able to identify with every bit of the story and the characters in it. Jesus is the best communicator out there. He knew their thoughts. We know that by scripture. He knew their heart. And he knew that he, when he spoke, was speaking the truth of things that were happening and things that were going to what? Come to happen. So I'm going to be reading from verse 1, but I want to just step back because this particular parable, this one's a wedding banquet, but while Jesus was at a Pharisee's house, he also told a similar story to this, found in Luke 14. Don't turn there, just put it down for your own notes. I just want to share a few things. It was the Sabbath day, and Jesus was sitting in the house of a prominent Pharisee having a meal. And you know what's happening? They were watching him. They were watching him very closely. And Jesus, in turn, was watching each of them. And as he's sitting there, he saw a man suffering from an abnormal swelling in his body. And Jesus, knowing that he was being watched, he asked this question of the experts of the law. Is it lawful to heal on the Sabbath or not? But they remained silent. So taking hold of the man, he healed him and sent him on his way. They knew they couldn't answer him. And then they asked him, if one of you has a child or an ox that falls into a well on the Sabbath day, will you not immediately pull him out? And that basically, he says, use common sense here. You would. So stop being so petty. Stop being so religious. Stop straining the gnat. And then he's sitting there and he noticed that the place of different people, they took the place of great honor, the seats of great honor. He's observing everything. He says, you religious leaders come in here and you know your position, so you're going to take that seat. And this guy says, well, you know, I'm not as big as him or as powerful, but I know that seat's good for me. And Jesus watched all of this. And he's trying to show them their heart and how they missed the mark. And so he goes on to say to them, if someone invites you to a wedding feast, do not take the place of honor, for a person more distinguished than you may have been invited. If so, the host who invited both of you will come and say to you, give this person your seat. Then, humiliated, you will have to take the least important place. But when you're invited, he starts to teach them, take the lowest place so that your host comes and says to you, friend, move up to a better place. Then you will be honored in the presence of all the other guests. For all those who exalt themselves will be what? Humbled, and those who humble themselves will be what? exalted. Then Jesus says to the host, when you give a luncheon or a dinner, do you not invite your friends, your brothers or sisters, your relatives, or your rich neighbors? If you do, they may invite you back so that you will what? Be repaid. But when you give a banquet, invite what? The poor. I want you to highlight this. The poor, the crippled, the lame, the blind. And you will all be blessed. Although they cannot repay you, you will be repaid at the resurrection of the righteous. Are we painting a good picture here in your mind? He goes on to say that there's a parable of a great banquet. Why did he start to tell this parable? Because one of them at the table screams out to Jesus, "Blessed is the one who will eat at the feast in the kingdom of God." Man, there's no greater place to talk about Jesus than around a dinner table. What does he say? I knock at the door of your heart. For any man or woman to open that door, I will what? Sup with them and they with me. Now, I want you to turn to Matthew 22. I asked you earlier. And we have here a great wedding banquet. And I want to just, before I start to read that, I want you to understand some of the things that were happening historically at this time. This would have been the last week of Jesus being on the earth in the flesh. The setting would have been on a Wednesday after he had cleared out the temple the day before. He would have entered into the great city on a Monday, riding on a donkey. He would have cleared out the temple. Remember, all the money changers, all of this was there. And then all of a sudden, Jesus is among all the people the following day. Temple cleaned out, house of prayer. Everybody came to see Jesus as a military might. Because, you know, they expected him to overthrow Rome. That was their thought process. And Jesus came and he started to speak with authority to all of these people. And the Jewish leaders that were there hearing them knew in all his stories, his parables, because he told three. We see in Matthew 21, he talks about two. And then the great banquet, the wedding banquet, is the third. I want you to understand, we've read these many of times, but these are warnings of judgment. And before he got to the third, the religious leaders had had it. And it says that they confronted him. Now, there's a great company of people. They confronted Jesus, and they wanted to know, by what authority do you speak? That shows you how little they understood that he was God. Show us your credentials. Show us how you have that REV before your name. Show us your rabbinical credentialing. And he's like, are you kidding me? You knuckleheads. I mean, that's typical of man today. Sammy, man, you know, you might be giving the gospel to somebody and then you have some religious nut next to you. Well, you show me your credentials. How you know that? Well, it's the Spirit of God living in me. That's how I know it. That's my credential. That's your credential. Because every one of us have been called to the Great Commission to preach the good news to everyone across the world. That's your credential. Guess what? My credentials have been given to me by the Church of God, but also by God. And every one of you has that right to walk in that power and in that anointing in the what? The truth of the Word of God. So Jesus is looking at these knuckleheads and he's saying, listen, I want you to understand this is it for me. And I'm going to preach a word that is in season. My question to you, if it was the end for you, And if it was the end for me, what would our message be to the world? And here's Jesus, a couple of days, the Wednesday and Friday, he's going to be crucified. He chooses to tell a story of a great wedding banquet. The story is so powerful that in this setting, everybody would have understood exactly who the players were. So he goes forth and he starts to tell this great story. Let's follow with me, if you don't mind. Verse 1. Jesus spoke to them again in a parable. And I want you to get this into your heart. He goes on to them, "The kingdom of heaven is like a king who prepared a wedding banquet for his son. He sent his servants to those who had been invited to the banquet to tell them to come, but they refused." Now, you and I, we might just glaze right over this, but I want to dissect it for a moment. I want you to understand. So Jesus is telling a parable, a story that would relate to the people of that day. And I want to kind of relate it to us. First of all, he says to them, the kingdom of heaven. There is no one better than Jesus to teach about what? The kingdom of heaven. Because where did he come from? Heaven. He came from that kingdom. His message while he was on earth was about what? The kingdom of heaven. And he goes on to say the kingdom of heaven is like this. The king has invited you to come to this great banquet. Okay. So let's talk about wedding feasts for a moment. Nobody would want to, if you were invited to a wedding, you wouldn't want to miss it. For a number of reasons. First of all, a basic wedding would last a week. You think weddings are expensive now. If you were back then, the wedding would last for a week. Now, the betrothment, or the actual marriage, took place already in a contract between the parents. So there was a whole bunch of preparation that would go on, and I'm not going to get into all of that. But a wedding would last a week, and the people who were throwing the wedding would have to feed you twice a day. Good stuff, right? Good stuff. And so the Jewish people ate twice a day. They would eat late morning, and they would eat in the evening. And so for a person being invited, and ladies, follow me on this, you wouldn't have to cook for a whole week. Somebody else would have to do the dishes. You were a guest. This is good stuff. And especially in a day when food was hard to come by, you wouldn't miss it. Now let's step back for a moment. All of a sudden, we have to change our setting. Because Jesus says, guess what? You've been invited to the king's banquet. And it goes on to describe his banquet. It's going to have the best of everything. And more often than not, because he's a king and it's his son, it's going to last 2 weeks. Somebody taking care of you for 2 weeks, you ain't missing that. And if the king invited you, you know, we got to look at it like this. It's kind of like if you and I were invited, because it was a monarchy of that day. We don't live under a monarchy. We live on a democratic society, which is not God's plan, by the way, because we can't govern ourselves at all. Can I get an amen? I don't care what side of the fence you're on. And so It would like you and I being invited to the White House to go to the president's son's wedding. That's what it had been like. You know, nothing for nothing, you and I would be going around bragging about it. Yeah. Huh. Yeah, Joe, I hate to use him as an example or his son, but, you know, the president invited me to go to his son's wedding. Every one of your neighbors would know you got that invite. You'd have it all over Facebook. You'd have it on Twitter. It would be staped and to your glued to your forehead. You would want everybody to know, I'm going to the White House. I got invited. And so I want you to picture what's going on here. A king invited you. That's what Jesus is saying. The King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, the great I Am, invited you to come to a wedding feast. And he sent invitations out. Because why? He sent his servants to those who had been invited to the banquet to tell them to come. But listen to these knuckleheads. But they refused. Who in their right mind would refuse the king? Who would refuse such an invitation? Can I just sidebar for a minute? Jesus has made the invitation to the whole world. Who in their right mind rejects Jesus as King and as Lord? But that's just a sidebar for a moment. But they refuse. Wait a minute. You sent the servants to those who had been invited, but they refused? Listen to what happens next. Then he sent some more servants. And he said, tell those who have been invited that I have prepared my dinner. Maybe they're not getting the message. My ox and fatted calf have been butchered. It's a barbecue. And everything is ready. He's saying, come to the wedding banquet. But they paid no attention and they went off. So I want you to understand something. Can I just say this? Walk with me. Man, they were invited in the Old Testament. And they were invited in the New Testament. To this great party. And they've refused him twice. Now, first of all, you don't refuse a king once. You know better, because he has the ability to take your head. And it may cost you your head if you refuse. So Jesus is telling his story, but they paid no attention and they went off. Now, listen to their feeble excuses. One to his field, another to his business. And we know one, if you go back to Luke, one talks about, well, me and my wife just got married. Well, if you just got married, wouldn't you want to go to another party? And the one who went to go look at his land that he just bought, well, nobody buys land without looking at it first. And then the other one who has to deal with his ox, you know, I got to go deal with some business. I want you to understand, these are feeble excuses. And they were written this way to describe nobody in their right mind would do this. Nobody buys a field without looking at it first. No newly married who just came out of, man, of course we want to go as a husband and wife to a party together. And the king's party on top of it. And the other one says, yeah, I got to deal with some smelly ox. I got to go purchase them. I mean, what's more important than this? Every one of them a feeble excuse. It goes on to say that they seized his servants, mistreated them, and killed them. Talking about the prophets. Talking about John the Baptist. And soon to be Jesus. The king was enraged. He sent his army and destroyed these murderers and burnt their city. A lot of people read that and just go on to the next thing. Then he said to his servants, the wedding banquet is ready. I want to step back for a moment. We have to hear what Jesus is saying about those people who were supposed to be in heaven. Who were those who were invited? Who had those invitations first? The Jewish people. What did Jesus come for first? For the Jew. The religious leaders of that day would have had the golden envelopes. They should have. The people should have understood the Messiah was coming. And I'm ready for that wedding banquet. They were waiting. A lot of the people. Who's watching The Chosen on TV? Right? It's pretty neat, right? People are so excited. They wanted the Messiah to come, right? So Jesus came for the Jews. The prophets came for the Jews. They weren't trying to win the Gentiles yet. All the Old Testament was about the Jews. All that Jesus was doing first was about the Jews. And then when the Jews, after 3 years of hearing Jesus' message, as he lived with them, as he walked with them, the Immaculate Conception, all that took place, all the signs, all the miracles, such power had been seen to all of the Jews, it came to a point when Jesus is in the temple teaching and he's on his final leg, and he says, you know what? You guys have been invited. You have rejected me. Now me and my Father have rejected you. Remember, they were questioning his authority. He gave them two warnings already in parables. Now this is his third and final warning. And brothers, I don't know who you may be, or sisters, I don't know who you may be, but this could be your final warning. And my final warning to make sure my house is in order. That I don't misplace the invitation. So he sent his armies to destroy them, it says. 70 years later, the Jews were just getting a little bit too rambunctious. And Roman leaders had had enough. And they came and overthrew the Jews. A big war took place. They burnt the temple. They looted the temple, the Romans. I want you to imagine this. The great historian, Josephus, wrote that 1.1 million Jews were killed. You reject me? You rejected my invitation. I have been here from the beginning and inviting you in, Jesus says. But since you have rejected me, my Father and I have rejected you. Can you see the story? It takes a little bit of a different look on things, right? 950,000 Jews were taken into slavery. They were completely displaced until 1948. We could say, man, God really holds a grudge, right? Well, you know, that's thousands of years, right? But to the Lord, what, a day is 1,000 years and 1,000 years a day? I don't know, but, you know, he reestablished the Jews. But let's go back. We see this great destruction take place because of the rejection that they had towards the Messiah. And God brought judgment. The Romans destroyed the temple. They destroyed everything in Jerusalem, everything that was sacred. But then everything shifts in verse 8. Then he says to his servants, the wedding banquet is ready. What? But those I invited did not deserve to come. So listen to what he says next. And these are the people who are going to make it to heaven. Amen? So go to the street corners and invite to the banquet anyone you find. It's no longer for Jew alone. Ooh, good stuff. How many of you are pure-blooded Jew in this room? Raise your hand. I'm glad you caught yourself, brother. Your last name is not Horowitz. Listen, I want you to understand something. This is where it shifts. In other words, he brought judgment. He was done with them. And he says, those people have rejected me. They were invited and didn't deserve to come. They refused to come. They all had their excuses when they should have answered the call of Jesus. So go to the street corners and invite to the banquet anyone you find. That's me. That's you. That's the Gentiles. Anyone. The Samaritans. Anyone. The drug addict. The prostitute. The liar. The thief. And I'm going to get into that in a moment. Listen. He goes on to say, so go to the street corners and invite them to the banquet, anyone you find. So the servants went out into the streets and gathered all the people they could find, the bad as well as the what? Ooh. The bad as well as the good. Because whether your righteousness is good or your righteousness, you think your righteousness, is it bad? Listen, it doesn't matter. The invitation's out there for you. It doesn't matter what your history looks like. It doesn't matter what your presences look like. It just matters if you say, I want to go to the wedding feast.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
I want to go. I'm not going to look at my past. I want to look to a better future. I've been invited. The call has been sent out to everyone in this room, to everybody who's watching on TV. You've been invited to the wedding feast. We already know what happens to somebody who rejects it. And we know on the final day of judgment, those who have rejected Jesus Christ, good or bad. Well, I don't understand. Good people don't make it to heaven? No, they don't. The Bible teaches me that my righteousness, my works, the thing that I think gets me to heaven is filthy rags before the Lord. It's only Jesus. And the cup that we shared and the blood that was shed gets you and I into heaven. Let me kick going here. So the servant went out to the streets and gathered all the people they could find, the bad as well as the good, and the wedding hall was filled with guests. All right, now, when we read in Luke, it says that there was still room in the banquet hall. So he sent his servants back out into the highways and into the byways, into the bushes. Brother, I don't know about you. Who lives in bushes? Don't look at the tent that's behind the church right now. It's on that side over there. I mean, man, people who don't have a home. People who don't have a place to... They're nomads, people that are less fortunate than most. There's a call going out to those that live in pipes. Those that live in the woods under a blue tarp. To those who stand on the corner and will say, anything will help. And not to get into the depths of my future messages, but if we look at the Bible, who's in heaven? Well, there was a story that Jesus told about a guy named Lazarus, who everybody would have known, and a rich guy. And when Lazarus died, and the rich man died, who was in Abraham's bosom? The guy who was covered in what? sores, who lived out by the gates. He had nothing except he had everything because he was clothed in the righteousness of God. Let me get going. Are you all with me? It's a good story, right? Next time you go to a wedding, you think of this story, okay? So, but when the king came in to see his guests, now, I want you to understand something. This is really important. This is where we need to examine ourselves. He says, when the king came in to see his guests, he noticed a man there who was not wearing the wedding clothes. What do you mean? The wedding clothes. He asked the dude, how did you get in here without wedding clothes, my friend? The man was speechless. The king called the attendants, tie him hand and foot, and throw him outside into the darkness. So we know this would have been the nighttime of the wedding feast, a different period, because it started with breakfast. Now it's evening. And he says, in that darkness where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. For many are invited, but few are chosen. See, you and I can go to the wedding, but only God sees who is clothed in the wedding garments. See, the people of that day would have looked at the religious leaders and said, surely these guys are making it. Remember what Jesus says? Unless your righteousness exceeds that of the Pharisees, the Sadducees, and the scribe, by no means will you enter into the kingdom of heaven. And the disciples are like, well, then who could be saved? Not these guys. They have a form of godliness, but they lack the power thereof. So what gets you and I into heaven is a relationship with Jesus Christ. See, he clothes us in righteousness. He clothes us, as Revelation teaches, in the white garments. It's only accepting Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior that we get to wear these wonderful garments. And I don't care if you have the most wicked and filthy past, because he says the bad and the good were invited. It doesn't matter. If you have asked Jesus Christ for forgiveness, the Bible says he casts your sin as far as the east is from the west. And on top of it, he says, I throw it into the sea of what? To remember it no more. Here's the problem. And I'm like this. I don't know how many times I've asked God for forgiveness for the sins that I've already asked him to forgive me for. And God is sitting there going, did you do it again? I don't remember. I didn't do it again. But there's this dude called the devil and his henchmen who forever want to keep you down and broken and useless for the kingdom. So he constantly reminds you of your past. Now, this is what you need to do and what I need to do. You need to remind him of his future. Can I get an amen? Listen, I know I'm bound for glory. You're bound for glory. You need to have the righteousness of God in your life. You need to have that invitation in your heart. And you need to walk through this life with a smile on your face, knowing that one day I will enter into a great supper with the Lord one day. Why? How do I know this? Well, Jesus says, listen, I'm drinking of this wine, the grape, right now with you, but I won't drink again until we have that day in heaven together. What a day of rejoicing that will be when we all see Jesus. See, only you know the relationship. That's how this all started, that you have with God. Only you. I can look at every one of you and say, hey, we're all going to a wedding feast together. We all got the invitation. Did you accept it? And, you know, everybody in this room goes, yeah. But you know in your heart what kind of relationship you have with God. I know in my heart. I'm going to wrap it up right now. Baby, I want you to come. As I said earlier, the Bible says that we need to examine ourselves. You can have every one of the praise the Lords. You can have every one of the brother and the sister. You can know John 3:16, the Lord's Prayer. You can start quoting chapter and verse. And guess what? You don't have the garments. You don't have it. Because you don't have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. How do you develop it? Remember, this started out as a wedding. It's about relationship, not about religion. Well, I pay my tithes, I do this. Well, listen, so what? That's not relationship. Can I tell you something, men? Most men in a relationship are great providers, but not great communicators. The wife appreciates the financial security. That's our job. If we don't provide for our families, the Bible says that we're worse than a non-believer. But do you know what a wife needs the most? Conversation. Do I need, she's an amen. Do I need to go back to what we just spoke about words, remember? 30,000 words a day a woman speaks. And for some reason, she saves all of those words for you when you get home from work. And then the craziest things when she's done and you're like, okay, I got through this. No, you don't think that. Then she then turns and, you know, you're exhausted, you're wiped out, and then she goes, well, tell me about your day. But can I tell you something? When we communicate, our relationship is deeper. Yes. She's in my bubble, I'm in her bubble. There's nothing greater than being in the bubble of God. Right. Revelation comes, insight comes. Wisdom comes, direction comes, strength comes, faith comes, healing comes. When you're in his bubble, you're like a supernatural giant in a world that's in turmoil. People are terrified about the election. I'm not. I'm voting. I'm voting. But listen, I know who puts people in authority. God does. God puts people into authority. He also puts them in authority to bring judgment. Well, how do I know that? And then we're going to wrap this up. What did he do with Rome? He sent his army. What, you mean the Romans are his? Everybody's his. Everything is his. He uses everything for his sovereign will to be done on this earth. And he's using this very moment to speak in and through me to give you hope and a chance to have eternal life in his kingdom. Only if you choose to receive him as your Lord and as your Savior. Are you willing to do that today? Let's all stand together. Listen, we're opening up this altar. We're going to do it for two main reasons, but it's open to everybody. For first and foremost, I want to open up this altar for those who have never experienced Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. Who have never truly made that commitment. You might have said it with somebody in a prayer because they told you to. This is what you need to do to make it to heaven. It's a lot more than that. See, the Bible says, seek ye first the kingdom of heaven and his righteousness. Then everything else is in order. So it's not just a simple prayer, as Romans 10:9 teaches. When we believe in our heart and confess with our mouth, then it's living it out. What does living it out get you? The wedding garment. His righteousness, when you had said that prayer and believed that Jesus died, he imputed his righteousness. But you clothe yourself in this life by doing righteous deeds and acts. Well, isn't that works? No. That's shining your light in a world that is filled with darkness, because the Bible says when you shine that light, people will see your deeds and glorify your Father in heaven. So the Bible says that we need to walk out our salvation daily with fear and trembling. Yes. So if you have never truly committed your heart to Christ, I want you to do that, and I'll pray with you personally. I'll shut the mic off. We'll pray together. That'll be your new birth, your first time. And then it's for those that have been invited to the wedding feast. Remember, can I just say this? There was an analogy used with 10 virgins. 5 that were ready for the wedding. And 5 who didn't have their wicks trimmed and their lamps filled with oil. Each of them knew that one day the announcement for the wedding was coming. Remember, we talked about the love, our first love, a couple of weeks ago, maybe a month or two ago. That it talks about the last days, that people's love will grow cold because of the wickedness of our society. Do you know how many Christians are just angry people? They're angry at the world. They're angry at their government. They're angry at taxes. They're angry every time they buy food in the store. Have you ever met somebody like that? Dude, take this whole world, but give me Jesus. We're not angry people at all. We carry the love of Jesus. We're not bitter. We're not backstabbers. We're not two-faced. How many Christians are two-faced? Some of you go, oh, wait a minute. So, it could be me. Well, that's the invitation. The second are for those who have answered the call, but maybe you've kind of backslidden. Gotten angry, you've lost your first love. Those religious leaders, Jesus told this warning, this third and final parable, because in 2 days he's going to hang on a cross. His final message, if I could say that, a message of hope. A message to say, don't be religious. Have a relationship with me. It's what he was asking. Don't be like these guys. He says, I've been here for the Jews my whole life. We've sent prophets. John came. I came. You've rejected me. Guess what? My father and I have rejected you. And now the call goes out to everyone else. Only a fool would reject an invitation from a king. Don't be a fool today. The altar is open to you. Come and let us pray.
Are you hurting and broken there, overwhelmed by the weight of your sin? Jesus is calling. Have you come to the end of yourself? Do you thirst for a drink from the well? Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar, the Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus today. There's no reason to wait. Jesus is calling. Bring your sorrows and trade them for joy. From the ashes a new life is born. Jesus is calling. Oh, oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open. precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Come to the cross as you wait for a crown. Tell the world of the treasure you
The reason it's so important is that Jesus is trying to take our focus off of the things of this life and put them on kingdom things. He wants us to be kingdom-minded. You ever hear that saying, you're so kingly-minded, you're no earthly good? Oh, no, 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 don't believe that lie. You be holy, you be separate. You be kingdom-minded. You make decisions based upon the kingdom. Yes. And that was Jesus' message. Those people made decisions based upon their wants and their desires of this life. If those wants and desires are pulling you away from God, dispose of them. Delete them. The Bible says it's harder for a rich man to enter into heaven as it is for a camel to go through the eye of the needle. Literally. Because why? More often than not, their focus is on earthly things and not kingdom things. Ask yourself, are you kingdom-minded? Ask yourself, do you want his desires to be your desires? Ask yourself. He left us a great commission. Are you going out and preaching wherever you are the kingdom of heaven? Pastor, you're really just kind of telling me I need to delete everything around me. If Christ isn't first in your life, you hit that delete button. That's what I'm saying. Because the Bible tells me that God places people in all different positions in this life, and he even places people to be rich in this life, but to use their richness for his goodness, not for their own desires. Yes. 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 So, Father, we come to you today, Lord. Yes. And I want to first and foremost thank you for this word. Yes. Thank you as one of Jesus' messages, his final messages, Lord, a warning and also judgment. I want to thank you for giving us this word. Because, Lord, over the next several weeks, we're going to see what kind of person is going to make it to heaven. And, Father, a lot of us are going to be shocked and surprised. Even as you told during that day a story that everybody would have understood about Lazarus and the rich ruler. People of that day put a lot of emphasis on wealth as a blessing from heaven, but that's not true. Even the lies of ministries today preaching that teaching that prosperity. Listen, I am one of the richest people walking the face of this earth. But like Jesus says, my kingdom is not of this earth. So, Father, I just pray that you would open the hearts and the minds of your people to put you first. That, Father, maybe on the outward, I might think they're making it to heaven, but inwardly, they're not wearing the garment clothes for the wedding feast. The garments that truly show that we are clothed in the righteousness imputed by Jesus and the righteousness of walking with Jesus. Father, I pray for Julie Gordon. I pray for Teresa Bach. I pray complete healing in their bodies. I pray for anybody who's struggling here, suffering here. I pray that you would meet them in a mighty way. Now, Father, for the offering that had been given to this church body, Lord, I pray you would bless each person that gives. And Father, for those who struggle in giving because of maybe they just don't want to give. Father, that's a sacrament too. Sharing the offering has always been a sacrament. Father, I pray that you would change their heart. That you would motivate them to understand their giving to the kingdom of God. Investing in you. And for those who do give, Lord, and give freely, I continue to pray a blessing into their life, one that they could never contain. One that they can only give you glory and honor for. Now bless your people, I pray, in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Hey guys, real quick, there's no fellowship today. We have a meeting right after church for those that are in the administrative position. We ask that you stay behind. We're going to go right into the meeting. For all others, bless you. Don't forget, if you filled out one of those cards, see one of our ushers, they'll get you a gift. Hey, say hello one to another. Amen? Thanks. Say hello.
Thanks for everything.
Appreciate you, brother. Appreciate you.
Love coming here.
Oh, man. And I'll